Praise the Lord, and welcome to another Wednesday night online Bible study. December 16th. Wow. We are a little over a week from Christmas at this point, and 2 weeks until the year 2021. This year was definitely not what we thought it was going to be. After we left this church building on January the 1st, 2020, after watch night service, we probably thought this year was going to be a lot different than how it was. But through it all, Jesus has been good to us. We might have had some bad times, some heartaches, some lost loved ones that passed away along the way this year, but through it all, God has been good to us. So don't forget to reach out to each other. Show people how much you care. Show them love. Show them kindness. Remember the sick. Remember the hurting. Remember all the prayer requests. And definitely remember the Clemens family with their loss this holiday season. And to all the others around that has lost loved ones this close to Christmas. So God bless each and every one of you. Last week, we talked about the divided kingdom and how the Israelites was exiled from the promised land and how they returned back to Jerusalem. And we ended by talking about a very sad thing that happened at the very end of the Old Testament. The Old Testament, it ends with God's chosen people living outside of His wonderful love. They didn't hear a prophetic message from God for about 400 years. How sad is that? 400 years of silence from God. Those, like I said, those one or two pages inside of your Bible between the Old Testament and the New Testament, that is 400 years. 400 years. That blank page is 400 years of nothing from God. They had their warnings, just like we've had warnings throughout our lives, but they didn't listen. And every time I think about that, it almost makes me want to cry thinking about that. Thinking about not hearing from God, a message from God, God's own people not hearing from Him for 400 years. I don't even know, I can't even imagine in myself going a week, going a couple days without getting to being able to pray and really hear something from God. But thank God that even though the Old Testament ended on such a very sad note, we get hope and so much joy when we go into the New Testament. The Lord shows us that He did not leave us. It may have been a hard 400 years, but He did not leave us. And now He's going to set up a new covenant with His people. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank You, God, for this day, God. I thank You, God, for Your mercies, God, for Your grace, for Your love, and for Your kindness, Lord. I thank You, God, for Your healing power, God, and Your savings grace, Lord. And I ask You, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, just to reach down, God, to touch Your church, God. Move upon Your church. Help Your church to stay strong, God. Stand firm, God, in these times that we're living in, Lord. Let Your Spirit, God, flow through the church, God, to help Your people, God, to get strong in You, God, to do the work that You'd have them to do, Lord. And I ask You, Lord, to anoint my lips, God. Help me, God, this message, God, that You've given to me, God, that hearts and souls and minds will be touched, God, that somebody will get something out of it, God, they'll help them get closer to You, Lord. And I ask You, Lord, just bless our pastor, God, bless our church, God. Let Your Spirit flow, God. Let it move upon us, God, in this virus, God. Bring healing, God, to the sick and afflicted, God. Comfort, God, to those who need comfort today, Lord. And we give You all the praise and glory and honor for it all, God, because You are great, God. And so greatly to be praised, God, in the name of Jesus, God. Thank You, Lord. You, God, in the name of Jesus, God, You are so awesome, God. Thank You, Lord, and thank You, Jesus. So before we get going in the New Testament, we're going to do a little introduction to the New Testament. The books of the Bible from Matthew through Revelation are called the New Testament. And that is because it presents us with this new covenant that Jesus made. The Old Testament prophets had even prophesied, predicted the establishment of this new covenant way before it ever happened. Jeremiah 31 through 34, it says this, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them, by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I'll make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts. I will write it in their hearts and will be their God. And they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. And I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. So Jeremiah said that God would be giving them a new covenant, that the Lord would put his laws in their inward parts. He would write it in their hearts, that it would be different than what it was in the old covenant, that there would be that new covenant that would happen. And to me, that sounds a lot like something that we can pull out. This was an Old Testament prophet, but we can pull something out of the New Testament that shows us something very similar to this, that shows us what was happening. Hebrews 10, 9 through 16. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second, by the which we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Christ once for all. And every priest standeth daily ministering, offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified, whereof the Holy Ghost is also witness to us. For after that he said, to this the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their hearts, and in their minds I will write them. Jesus came long before the new covenant came. It had already been prophesied that it would happen. So Jesus, he came along and he set up a new covenant with his people, a covenant that will be in their hearts, that they can have the Spirit of God living in us, living in our hearts, living in our minds, God with us. We will get more into this as we go through the New Testament. But you can see since the very beginning that God, he had a plan. God had a plan. If you really study out the Old Testament, you can see everything in there leads up to what happens in the New Testament. He set up a way for us, the people who were not Jews, the people who was not of the seed of Abraham, to be in a covenant with him. So there are 27 books in the New Testament. And you can remember this by counting the letters in the words New and the Testament. There are 3 letters in the word New, 9 letters in the word Testament. 3 times 9 is 27. I know that may sound a little bit cheesy, but may help somebody remember that if they want to remember how many books of the Bible is in the New Testament. So the books of the New Testament were written over a period of approximately 50 years, and it covers about 100 years worth of history. Some of the writers that was used by the Holy Ghost to write the New Testament include Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Paul, James, Peter, and Jude, to name some of them. The New Testament, it's also divided into 5 different sections. You have the 4 Gospels, 1 book of history, the 13 Pauline epistles, and the 8 general epistles, and you have 1 book of prophecy. So it is important to recognize the purpose of each book and to whom it was originally addressed to, because that type of information will actually help you interpret the scripture. So the first 4 books in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are called the 4 Gospels. These books present more like a biography of the life of Jesus himself. They talk about his birth, his ministry, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. So Matthew was written primarily for Jewish readers because it strongly emphasizes Jesus Christ as the Messiah and the King predicted by the Old Testament prophets. Because it was showing the Jews that through the Old Testament that Jesus was the one talked about by the prophets. He really went into that. He really wanted them to see because they were into their scriptures and into their words. So he wanted them to see through the Old Testament, through the old prophets, that Jesus was the one that they talked about. Trying to make them take them from where they were at, the Old Testament, and show them all the way through the prophets to Jesus, through the word. Setting up, like we talked about in the Acts, setting up that common ground. It's setting that common ground in between them to show them Jesus Christ. So then you got the book of Mark. Mark, though, was written with Gentiles in mind. It shows Jesus as a servant who ministered to the needs of the people. It shows the supernatural power of Jesus, demonstrating that he is God by the miracles that he performed. It highlights the things Jesus said by showing you the things that he did. The Gentiles didn't have the history of the Jews. They didn't have that Old Testament history. They weren't indoctrinated with all of that past history of the Old Testament. So you could show them Jesus through God, through the Old Testament, and that was fine. But what helped them out even more, because they weren't dead set on that like the Jews were, what helped them out more was to show them that Jesus was the true God by showing what he could do in their lives. Because all they had was idols of stone, idols of wood, and that's what they worshiped. Gods that really couldn't do much anything for them. But now they could show them who God was and what God can do in their lives, and that there was a God that could hear and answer their prayers and do mighty works in their lives. Then you have the book of Luke. Luke presents Jesus as the Son of God. It focuses especially on the humanity of Jesus himself, showing Jesus's compassion for the weak, the suffering, and even the outcasts. Luke was also written with the Gentiles in mind. You can see this right off the bat, and I thought this was so interesting, right off the bat, by seeing how Luke, when Luke traces the Jesus's human genealogy, he starts and he traces it all the way back to Adam. And that's in Luke chapter 3. He traces it all the way back to Adam. And this is different than the book of Matthew, like I said, that was set up mainly for the Jews, because it talks about the genealogy of Jesus, and it takes it all the way back to Abraham, which is where they originated from, Father Abraham. But this way, he walked all the way back through and showed it all the way to Adam. Because Luke, he wanted people to clearly see that Jesus is your Savior. Everyone, not everyone that is a descendant of Adam, every human being, not just a Jew that's the descendant of Abraham, can be blessed by this God. That God came down in the flesh to bring salvation to the whole world, to the Jew and to the Gentile. So the first three Gospels, they kind of go together showing common views of an order of events surrounding the life of Christ. They all kind of come together and show you in a common view. But each book was intended, they were all intended for all of humanity, but they kind of also showed more for a different set of people. So Matthew, like I said, seems to have the foremost in his mind for a Jewish audience. Mark was more of a Roman audience, while Luke was more of a Greek-type audience. Because like I said, Matthew and the Scripture, the Jews were so indoctrinated in the Scriptures. So they were taught to view everything through a scriptural perspective. So Matthew quotes Old Testament again and again and again in his support of the claim that Jesus is the Messiah. So Mark and the authority, the Roman mind, it focused on government. Roman mind was on the governmental authority and governmental power. So Mark, he stresses the miracles of Christ, emphasizing his supernatural authority, because they were all about a governmental authority. So he said he has all the authority over all things. So Luke, and it was more about the glorious perfection of Jesus, because the Greek mind was attracted to culture. It was attracted to philosophy. It was attracted to wisdom, reason, beauty, and education. It was that Greek-type mind. So Luke presents a complete, in order. His book was more in order of events than any of the other ones. And it was a classical story. And it's sometimes called the most beautiful book that was ever written. The Gospel of Luke, it reveals the glorious beauty and the perfection of the ideal man, which is Jesus Christ. So the last gospel in the New Testament is John. And John comes in and balances the other three gospels by its special emphasis on the deity of Jesus. John begins in much the same way as the book of Genesis starts out. It reveals Jesus Christ is the Word made flesh, and that he was from the very beginning the creator of all things. John 1, 1 through 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. Oh, sorry, I messed up there. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. So John lets you know from the very first verse of the book of John, John chapter 1, verse number 1, how important the Word is, that God is His Word. And he goes on to tell us that God came into the world that He made, because nothing was made without God. And he talks about how the world did not even know God, even though God created it. In John 1 and 10, when it says, He was in the world, God was in the world, and the world was made by Him, but the world, it knew Him not. Because he was talking about Jesus himself. God came down in the form. He was in the world that he made, and the world did not even know him. John wanted to point out the things Jesus said more than what Jesus did. He was very concerned about writing down what Jesus said. So then that takes us into the book of Acts. Because the first four books in the New Testament presents that historical account of Jesus Christ himself. The next book, Acts, provides this historical account of the very early church, the beginning of the church. Acts was written by a man named Luke the physician. And Luke starts off his book from the last moments of Jesus while he still remained here on earth. And it goes on to record the establishment of the New Testament church in Jerusalem. It shows how the gospel moved across the then known world, even though there was all types of opposition, all types of persecution was going on, the Word of God, the gospel still spread throughout the whole world. And that lets us know that no matter what is going on in this world today, we may think we're getting beat down by the virus, by the government, and there's all these conspiracy theories, different things going around. But it lets us know that no matter what's going on, what opposition, what persecution, that nothing can stop the spread of the gospel. The gospel will go on. And it is our job to go spread that gospel, to go spread it to the world. And what Acts also shows us is how to be saved. Acts 2 and 38. Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. We must repent of our sins, not just saying we're sorry, but really feel sorry for our sins, and then make a complete 180 turn and go in the other direction. Like Brother Jonathan was talking about on Sunday, the road less traveled. There's only one path that leads us to heaven, and we need to go down that path, and we do it by following the Word of God. Then we must be baptized. It says, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, for the remission of our sins. And that is being fully submerged into water. Like I've said before, and others have said, it is not that water that really washes away the sins, but it is the obedience to the Word of God. And that's what we really try to get across to everybody. It's the obedience to the Word of God. We need to listen to what the Word of God says. You have to trust and believe in Him enough to do it. And some people say, well, do you really need to be baptized? Mark 16, 15 through 16 says this. It says, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world. Jonathan had these scriptures on Sunday. And preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth, because first you got to believe and is baptized, shall be saved. You must first believe. So like I said, if you don't believe and get baptized, then you just got wet. But if you believe and you are baptized, and you shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. We must believe. We must trust. We must believe. Obey. Acts 2:38, it gives us two commands. It tells us two commands. Repent and be baptized. That is our part. Our part is to repent. Our part is to be baptized. Then God does his part. And if we do our part, I can promise you, he will always do his part. It says we shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. That is God's part. You don't have to pay for it or even be worthy enough for it. It is a gift, the gift of the Holy Ghost, to those who will turn their lives over to God, follow down that path less traveled. And the New Testament, it is full of the acts of the Holy Ghost and how it can help you live the life God wants you to do. Acts also tells you who the Holy Ghost is for. If you jump on to Acts 2 and 39, it says, "For the promise it is unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call." It is for you. It is for your children. It's for all of those that are far off. It was for them over 2,000 years ago, and it is for you today. Today is your day. Today is the day of salvation. And you know what? I saw this, and I wanted to make a point here on this. I want to point out here that it says, for your children also. So more than passing down money, a land, a family name to be blessed by, we need to pass down the name of Jesus and the plan of salvation to our children and our children's children. If we leave them with nothing else, if we die and leave this world and leave them with nothing else but the Word of God and salvation, then we have left them the greatest gift that they can ever receive, the gift of eternal life, the gift of eternity in heaven with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's better than anything you can leave your kids when you leave this earth. It's better than any present that you can put underneath your Christmas tree on Christmas Day. It is the greatest gift ever. Make sure you pass that down to your children, to your whole family, because the promise is unto them all. The promise of the Father, that Holy Ghost was poured out upon the waiting believers in Acts chapter 2. The establishment of the church was prophesied in the Gospels. The Gospels talked about how the church was going to be established, and then it was accomplished in the book of Acts. To understand how the church was founded, it is necessary to study the book of Acts. And I hope by now you know a little bit more about the book of Acts, since, like Jonathan liked to point out to me, I talked about it for, 100 weeks straight or something. So the book of Acts, it records the history of how the New Testament church was born. And it's something, if you want to be part of the church, get into the book of Acts and you will see how the church was founded and what you need to do to be part of the New Testament church. So the epistles, the first 21 books after Acts are the epistles. They're also known as the letters to the believers in churches. It was telling them how to live the victorious Christian life. And the epistles, they were not written to tell you how to be saved. They weren't written for that reason. They were written to the people who's already saved. They teach us. That's why they're right after Acts. If you follow through Acts and you learn how to be saved, then you can go into the epistles and you can see how to live the life God wanted you to live. They teach the church how to stay saved, how to grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, to help strengthen the church and help strengthen that body of Christ. Paul, he wrote 13 epistles that identify him as the author. They're called the Pauline epistles. They were letters to the churches. Some were churches he helped start, and others were churches that he had been there and he'd ministered and helped them grow in Christ. We're talking about places like Rome, Corinth, Ephesus, all of those places. He wrote the churches to give them guidance, to help them out, to teach them what they needed to know to stay the course and to follow after Jesus. He gave them guidance and wisdom to live by. Some had warnings of what to stay away from. Stay away from this and don't do this, or else it will pull you away from the church. It will pull you away from God and send you on the wrong path. So within the Pauline epistles are three books commonly called the pastoral epistles. That's 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus. And they're called that because they offer instructions concerning leadership in the churches to show leaders what they need. Timothy, the books of Timothy, Timothy was like a son to Paul. 1 Timothy 1 and 2, it even says, "Unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord." Paul wrote Timothy, Paul loved Timothy, and he wrote him to tell him to guard the gospel, hold on to the gospel, guard that, preach the word, and endure any hardship that would come to fulfill his charge as a minister. So those books show how leadership in churches should act, what and what to do. And it tells us that we should always guard the gospel. We should always preach the word no matter what is going on, no matter the state of the world and the people around us. We must hold on if no one else does. The next eight books, Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and Jude are called the general epistles because most of them were originally written to the churches at large, to the whole church in general. They were not written to a certain church like the church of Ephesus or the church of Corinth. They're written for the whole church as a whole. Teaching the church and giving the church guidance, uplift them, encourage them. Each of these books besides Hebrews has the name of the author as the book's title. But Hebrews, it doesn't really say for sure who the author was, but most people usually regard it as Paul being the author of Hebrews. And then we get to the last book in the New Testament, the book of Revelation. And it stands in a class all by itself. It's not like any of the other books of the New Testament. It is considered a book of prophecy. Revelation starts off with letters to the seven churches located in Asia Minor. The letters to the seven churches are as much for them that day as they are for us today, because it shows us that what Jesus Christ himself loves and what Jesus values in his churches and what he hates and what Jesus condemns and what Jesus will not deal with and what he will destroy. We can get a clear statement from reading them from Jesus regarding the consequences of our disobedience and our spiritual neglect. And we can also see the rewards for staying spiritual and staying faithful just by reading those seven letters to the seven churches. And it also gives us the standard to by which any church or any person can judge their spiritual state before God. Read that. If you can fall in with all those categories and everything that God loves and what he loves, and if you're away from all those things he dislikes, it will show you, it can judge your walk in God. And it also gives us an example of the devil's methods for attacking the churches or the individual Christians. So the book of Revelation was written by John, and he was told to just write what he sees. Revelation 1 and 19 is what he was told. Write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. So after the letters to the seven churches, Revelation starts to get into prophecy of the end times. We don't have to understand it all, but we got to read it and study it. Things that are going to happen until the end of the world, where God's people are going to be with him in the end, and their reward that's going to come to them if they stay firm until the end. And it also shows what's going to happen to the people that's fallen after the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, and the punishment that will happen if they don't turn their lives around. So in these next set of lessons that we're going to get into in exploring God's Word, we're going to be diving into the New Testament. We made it through the Old Testament. Now we're going to be getting into the New Testament, learning about the man that paved the way for Jesus Christ to come, which is John the Baptist. We're going to talk about the birth, the life, the death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the pouring out of the Holy Ghost, how Jesus rose again and how the church was born. We will get into the gifts of the Spirit. We'll talk about holiness, how to live a life that Jesus wants you to live, how to be a Christian. We even get into a little bit about the signs of the end times and Jesus coming back for his church. I can tell you right off the bat, I don't know a lot about the end times. I can't really tell you for sure what's going to happen. We'll go over some stuff, but I can tell you from the very beginning, if you want somebody that can tell you what all Revelation means, you definitely don't want to come to me. I do not know for sure, but I will give you what God gives me. The New Testament is full of great insight in what pleases God, what pleases Jesus, and it shows us how to live, how to act, and how to walk. And any problem that you run into, I'm sure that you can open up the Bible and you can find an answer for that problem. We all must get into the Word of God and search out the Word of God and study the Word of God. 2 Timothy 2:15, it's been quoted many of times. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Because Jesus, he is looking for a group of people who thou love him, a group of people that will serve him. And the only way we know how to please God, and the only way we'll know how to serve God and serve him is through reading the word of God, getting into the word of God, studying it, doing this study that we're going through here. It will not hit everything. There will be great stories and advice given by great men of God in the New Testament that we may not hit, that has lived a life that made it to heaven, people that we can glean so much stuff from. The Bible can help you stay that course if you just read it, if you study it. The Word of God can help you hold on until the end and get that crown of righteousness that's been laid up for you. In 2 Timothy 4:7-8, I've fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all us even today that love his appearing. We must love his appearing. We must get into the Word of God. I know I've said it quite a bit these past few weeks, but I just want you all to remember that, especially during this time that we're living in, that the prize is at the very end. Brother Jonathan even talked about on Sunday all those exit ramps that people's taken off from the path going into heaven. There's so many exit ramps, people leaving, but those people, they're not going to win. They're not going to get that crown of righteousness that's laid up for them. You got to stay on the path. You got to fight to the end. So keep fighting that great fight, that good fight. Stay the course. Keep the faith. If you do so, it tells us here in Timothy that there will be a crown of righteousness laid up for you. Get into the Word of God. Study it. It is the most important book that was ever written, and the book that can help save your life, the book that can make sure you end up in heaven and not hell. And don't just always take somebody's word for what's in the Bible and how to please God. I'm not saying don't trust the pastor and the men of God that he's put there to teach and preach unto you, but don't just take it always from their word. Open up that Bible, search it out, study it for yourself. Study the Word of God and let the Word of God speak to you. As I know, the more that I read in the Word of God, it speaks to me, and God speaks to me through the Word of God. So I'm getting ready to close here in a minute, but I just want to challenge each and every one of you this Christmas to take some time out of your day, Christmas Day, to just sit down and read the story. If anything else, just read the story of the birth of Jesus, both in Matthew and in Luke, because when they tell the story of his birth, read it and let it sink in what God did for us. He didn't have to come down in the form of flesh. God did not have to do that. He is God Almighty. He did not have to do that, but he did it. And he was born not in some big fancy place, but he was born in a manger. He did it all for us because he had a plan from the very beginning of time to get us into that new covenant, to get us a chance at salvation. That is how much your Savior loves you. So think on Jesus this Christmas. Read the birth, the story of Jesus in Matthew and Mark. Read it into the Word of God. Think on Him and remember the reason for this season that we're getting into. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I thank You, God, for Your Word. God, I thank You, God, for truth. God, You, God, for salvation. God, for the Holy Ghost. God, I thank You, God, for the Bible. God, for Your Word of God that we can dig into, Lord, and we can get the words that will help us out, Lord, that in, when we read the Word of God, that You speak to us through it, Lord, and that You can show us things, God, that can help us down the path that we're walking, Lord. The problems that we may run into, Lord, we know, God, that there's an answer right there in the Bible, God, that You had a plan, Lord, and that You have a path, and You have a way, and we know that we walk down that path less traveled, that if we stick the course, God, that You have that crown of righteousness laid up for us, Lord, and we know that through You, God, all things are possible, Lord, and ask You, God, to bless the church. Help the church to stay strong, God, through this Christmas season, God, to remember You, God, that it's not just a day of presents, God, Father God, but it's a day, God, full of praise, God, to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, God, that came down from heaven, God, that was born in a manger for us, Lord, that has suffered all that You suffered, God, for us, because You love us that much, Lord. You love us that much, Lord. And I thank You, God, that even though I least deserve it, God, that I am just a sinner, God, full of sin, God, that I can be stiff-necked, God, hard-headed, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, that You still love me, God, and You still came down, God, was born in a manger, God, born on this earth, God, born in the flesh, God, to feel what I feel, Lord, that You can give me that covenant, that You can save my soul, and I give You all the praise and glory and honor for it all, God, in the name of Jesus, God, because You are great, God, and greatly to be praised, God, and there's no one like You, God, in all the earth, God. Thank You, Lord, and thank You, God, for Your goodness, God, grace, and for Your love, Lord. And Merry Christmas, church. This is my last Bible study before Christmas, so I want to wish you all a Merry Christmas, and I hope it is a wonderful Christmas. Stay strong in Christ, and really dig into the Word of God. Merry Christmas to you all, and to all, God bless you.